everybody. This is Shilpa Banerjee from Skills and It Consulting. Today we are doing the Karnataka State Syllabus Class 7 Social Science History Lesson Number 2 Bahamani Adil Shahs Part 1. Today we will see how the Bahamani Empire came into being, who are some of the famous rulers of the Bahamani Kingdom. So let's first see the scenario or the situation in which the Bahamani Empire came into being. So if you look at the history of Karnataka, Vijayanagara Empire was established in 1336 as we've already learnt in first lesson, right? Later on 3rd August 1347, the first Muslim dynasty, Bahamani Empire, came to exist. So if you look at it, it's more or less the same time. Correct? So it's more or less the same timeline during which two of the most prominent kingdoms came into being in southern India. So Bahamani Empire is also known as Bahamani Sultanate or Bahamani Kingdom. So if you see different names in different books, don't get confused. It's all the same. So, it was a Persianate Muslim empire of the Deccan South India. The word Persianate means that they were heavily influenced by the Persian culture, Persian language. So, it was more or less all of Persian customs and traditions that were followed during the Bahamani Kingdom. It was the first independent Muslim kingdom of the Deccan and was known for its perpetual wars with their Hindu rivals of Vijayanagara. So obviously we already had Delhi Sultans or the Delhi Sultanate in the north, but in the Deccan, that is in the south, Bahamani Empire was the first independent Muslim rule, okay, or the Muslim kingdom, and they were constantly in wars with Vijayanagara. As we've already seen, two of the most powerful dynasties, they almost came to power at the same time. So if you look at their constant rivalry, it's not just two rulers. Over the generations, you will see Vijayanagara different Vijayanagara rulers being involved with different Bahamani kingdom rulers. It was established in the northern part of Vijayanagara Empire. So if you look at the map, it was in the northern part of the Vijayanagara Empire. They were the two neighboring kingdoms. Bahamani Empire was in northern part of Krishna River and Vijayanagara Kingdom or the Empire was in the southern part of the Krishna River. What are the places that Bahamani Kingdom had in its kingdom? It had parts of the present Karnataka, Maharashtra and Andhra Pradesh or Telangana. So if you look at this map, the shaded part that you see, that was the Bahamani Empire and this part was the Vijayanagara Empire. So you will get a clear picture that these were the two neighboring kingdoms. In the beginning, Kalburgi and later Bidar were their capitals. Tajuddin Firoz Shah was the greatest Sultan of Bahamani dynasty. So let's see how the Bahamani Empire came into being. Alauddin Hasan Gangu Bahman Shah, he was the first emperor or the ruler of the Bahamani Kingdom. He ruled from 1347 to 1358. The Bahamani Empire was established in 1347 by Alauddin Hasan Gangu Bahman Shah. He was earlier working in the army of Delhi Sultan Muhammad bin Tughlaq. You might have all heard about Muhammad bin Tughlaq. He is one of the very famous rulers of the Delhi Sultanate. Now, Alauddin Hasan Gangu, he had some difference of opinion with Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So, Bahamani Sultanate or the Bahamani Empire was founded as a revolt against Muhammad bin Tughlaq of the Delhi Sultanate. So, Alauddin Hasan Gangu had difference or he revolted against his ruler, and there were also some of the very influential people who supported him because they were also not very happy with the Delhi Sultanate. So that is how the Bahamani Empire came into being. So after that, it was Muhammad Shah I. Alauddin was succeeded by his son Muhammad Shah I, who ruled from 1358 to 1377 AD. He was an able general and an administrator. He defeated Kapaya Nayaks of Warangal and the Vijayanagara ruler Bukka I. And after that, the next ruler was Muhammad Shah II, who ruled from 1378 to 1397. He ascended the throne in 1378. He was a peace lover and developed friendly relations with his neighbors. He built many mosques, madrasas. Madrasas are place of learning, or in present day what we call as universities, that is what was called as madrasas, and hospitals. The next important ruler was Tajuddin Firoz Shah, who ruled from 1397 to 1422. He was the great sultan in the Bahmani dynasty. He is one of the most important rulers of the Bahmani empire. He expanded his kingdom and even succeeded in conquering the Raichur Doab from the Vijayanagara kingdoms. He defeated the Vijayanagara ruler Devaraya first. So if you look at their history, each ruler of Bahmani empire always fought with one of the rulers of the Vijayanagara empire. He was liberal, judicious, and a believer of God. He made copies of Quran and edited it for his whole life. So that shows, despite being a very famous king, despite having many successes in his military assignments, he was still very religious. He was very judicious. He gave lot of importance to law and order, and he believed in God, and he also believed in spreading the message of God through Quran. He was a writer and encouraged all languages. So this is something we all need to appreciate, that the rulers in those days, because if you look at it geographically, they had people who spoke different languages, Telugu, Marathi, Kannada, Urdu, right? So, but these rulers, they did not confine encouraging literature only to their language, but they encouraged all the other languages. This is something that really needs to be appreciated, that speaks about their broad-mindedness. He was an expert in geometry and theology. Geometry, I'm sure all of us know, all of you must be studying in your schools. Theology is the study of the nature of God and religious belief. In simple words, theology is the study of God and religion. So he was religious, he was pious, he was a great ruler. Apart from that, he was also an expert in these subjects. He sheltered many philosophers, poets, artists, and honored them. He established an observatory in Daulatabad, which is in the current Maharashtra state. Now, what is an observatory? It's a room or a building housing an astronomical telescope or other scientific equipment for the study of natural phenomena. So this is a building exclusively for keeping one of the instruments which helps you observe any heavenly bodies or heavenly phenomena. Okay, so that is what an observatory is, and he built it. He propagated the beauty of his capital Kalburgi. Kalburgi obviously is a very beautiful place. So he propagated. That means he really appreciated, and he always spoke about it. He built a new city called Firozabad on the bank of Bhima River. He gifted many villages to a Sufi saint, Bande Nawaz, who arrived in the kingdom during his period. He is a very famous Sufi saint. He concentrated on the development of ports, and as a result, foreign trade was encouraged. So if you see, during his rule, there was all-round development in art, literature, in geographical conquest, in military conquests. So in all the ways there was development. That's why he is one of the most important rulers of the Bahmani Empire. He abdicated the throne to his younger brother Ahmad, who was considered a saint by both the Muslims and Hindus. Firoz Shah died on 1st October 1422 in Gulbarga. So if you look at it, this is the tomb of Tajuddin Firoz Shah. Now let's learn a little bit about Ahmad Shah, who ruled from 1422 to 1435. As I told you already, he was considered a saint by both Muslims and Hindus. Muslims consider him to be a Wali. Wali means a friend of God. And Hindus consider him to be an avatar of Allama Prabhu, a Vachana poet who lived before Baswa. So Baswa, now all of us know, a great Vachana poet. So that was the time of Vachana Sahitya, what we call as Vachana Sahitya. So Allama Prabhu was also a great Vachana poet before Basavanna. Okay. So see, this is something really great, Because if people of both the religions consider somebody to be a god or an avatar of a saintly person, or considers that person to be a friend of God, so that says that this person was really very good. Otherwise, it is very natural to have reverence, it is very natural to have fear, it is very natural to have a pride for your ruler. But if you're considering your ruler to be a saintly person, you're considering him to be a godly figure, that is something that not many of the rulers can achieve. So if he achieved it, that means he was really a good person along with being a good ruler. He is the only king to be treated as such by his followers. His tomb in the funerary complex of Ashtu just outside Bidar is venerated by Muslims. So if you visit Bidar, even today you can see his tomb. This what you see in the picture here is Ahmed Shah's tomb. It has well preserved murals and verses from the Quran. So even now if you go to Bidar, you can visit this. And this tomb is the tomb of his queen or the empress. They are both in the Ashtur village of Bidar district. He was a great patron of arts and culture. He brought artisans from Iran, including the metal worker Abdullah bin Kaiser, who was the master of pottery ware, the inlaying of zinc alloy with silver and gold. So that was a unique type of art. Okay, so this shows that he did not want to compromise on the quality. So he even brought artists from outside to ensure that the work is done to perfection. So some of the other rulers of the Bahmani Empire after him, so we will not spend too much of time on them because they're not so important and it's not mentioned in your textbook. We will just mention the names and the time period during which they ruled. So we had Alauddin Ahmad Shah Bahmani, who ruled from 1436 to 1458. Alauddin Humayun, who ruled from 1458 to 1461, Nizamuddin Ahmad III, who ruled from 1461 to 1463, and Shamsuddin Muhammad III, or who is also known as Muhammad Shah III, who ruled from 1463 to 1481. Now this is very important. We have to learn about the reign of Muhammad Shah III because that is when Muhammad Gawan comes into picture. All of you must have heard about Muhammad Gawan. He is a person of great importance in history. Now what happened and why Muhammad Gawan became such an important person in the Bahmani Empire is, Muhammad Shah III was only 9 years old when he became the king. Okay, so obviously at 9 years, you could become a king for the name's sake, but you cannot really take decisions. Okay, so what happened? Muhammad Gawan was appointed as the prime minister and he remained in supreme authority till his execution in 1481. So Muhammad Gawan was already there in the court. Okay, but during Muhammad Shah III's coronation, Muhammad Gawan was appointed as a prime minister. That means Muhammad Gawan was responsible for all the important decisions. So let's learn about Muhammad Gawan because, as I told you, he's a very important person. All credits for making Bahmani dynasty great goes to Muhammad Gawan. He was a Persian by origin. That means he was from Persia. He was an able administrator. So what are some of the important factors or contributions of Muhammad Gawan? First, he enlarged the boundaries of the kingdom. He captured Hubballi, Belagavi, Goa from the Vijayanagara Empire. Administration was according to the Islamic law. So again, he too was a very religious person. He ensured that all the decisions, all the rules and regulations were in accordance with the Islamic laws that were mentioned in the Quran. He encouraged revenue and postal services. He fixed taxes on the basis of lands, fertility and irrigation facility. Tax was collected in cash. So instead of just saying if you have this much, these many acres, you will pay this much tax. What he did was, it was quite a revolutionary thing. He fixed taxes not on the basis of how much land a person held, but on the basis of land's fertility. That means what was the agricultural produce or what was the irrigation facility available in that particular piece of land. He removed some of the taxes which were annoying the people. So there were some unnecessary taxes that were levied on the people, which really hurt them. Okay, which really hurt their pockets. So what he did was, he did away with all those taxes. As a philosopher himself, Mohammad Kavan founded Madrasa. As I told you already, Madrasa is nothing but a university in Bidar. So what you see here in this picture is a Madrasa that was built by Mohammad Kavan. This shows that he gave a lot of importance to philosophy and education and not just to military conquests. This is also another angle of the Madrasa built by Mohammad Kavan. So if you go to Bidar, if you visit this site, this is what is written there about the Madrasa. I'll just read through it so that you get an idea about the Madrasa. Madrasa of Khwaja Mohammad Kavan. The Madrasa at Bidar is a distinguished example of Bahmani architecture, that is Persian style, built in AD 1472 by Khwaja Mohammad Kavan, the minister of Mohammad Shah III, AD 1463-82. It was functioned like a residential university and was maintained on the lines of Madrasa of Khurasan. It comprises a conventional quadrangular hall and chambers on all sides. This three-storied building houses mosque, library, lecture halls, professors' quarters and students' cubicles. The library that existed on the other wing is now destroyed. On three sides there are semi-octagonal projections crowned by bulbous and on the fourth side is the main entrance flanked by two stately three-stage minars. The facade is adorned with multicolored tiles in green, yellow and white in a variety of designs, arabesques and Quranic verses. Even though the building suffered much damage due to explosion of gunpowder in AD 1695, it still retains much of the original architecture features. It's the only one of its kind in India. So if you see, you can imagine, even back then, somebody thought about a university which had teachers' quarters, which has a hostel for students, which had a huge library. So you can imagine how big it must have been and how useful it must have been for the students and the teachers alike. And this shows that education was given a lot of importance even back then. So what happened in this madrasa? It encouraged Islamic religious and legal education. This was the main thing. But apart from this, subjects studied by students were astronomy, mathematics and history. Free education and hostel facilities were provided. There were around 3000 manuscripts in the library. That means it was a huge library. So ultimately what happened, like all good things come to an end, Mohammad Kavan's time also came to an end. Mohammad Kavan, see what happened, the Bahmani Empire reached its zenith, its peak during his, when he took over and when he was taking care of the kingdom. He contributed a lot in making the Bahmani kingdom great. Not just in military conquest, but in the all-round development in art, architecture, literature, education. In all the ways, Mohammad Kavan ensured that Bahmani kingdom reached its zenith. But regional leaders were jealous of his fame and they conspired to have him murdered. So now what happens whenever somebody becomes very successful? Naturally, that creates enemies. Okay, so this is exactly what happened in Mohammad Kavan's time also. Many of the regional leaders could not tolerate his publicity, his success. So they decided to have him killed. Now, how did they do it? Mohammad Kavan's seal was affixed to a forged letter purporting to invite the king of Orissa to invade the kingdom. That means Mohammad Kavan's seal was used by somebody else in a false letter, okay, which said the letter, it was written as if Mohammad Kavan is inviting the Orissa ruler to attack Bahmani Empire, okay. And then this letter, obviously it was not written by Mohammad Kavan. Somebody misused his seal and wrote this false letter and they gave it to the Sultan, the Mohammad Shah III. This letter was placed in the Sultan's hand. Unfortunately, instead of going to the depth of the truth, the Sultan believed this. Okay, so he was thus falsely accused and was put to death by Sultan's order. So without even thinking twice, Sultan just believed this letter, unfortunately, and he ordered Mohammad Kavan to be killed. So you can see that how innocent and a loyal person, because of conspiracy by somebody, he was killed. So if you see in his tomb, it's written innocent Kavan was killed. So obviously his innocence was proved later. The emperor realized his mistake, but it was too late. The death of Muhammad Kavan was a serious blow to the Bahmani power, because he was the only one person who was very powerful, who could hold all the regional leaders together, who could hold the Bahmani kingdom as one, because he was very intelligent, he was very strong. Okay, but unfortunately, it was this crime, that is the assassination or the killing of Muhammad Kavan, which ultimately led to the dissolution of the Bahmani kingdom. So after Muhammad Kavan died, nobody could really hold the kingdom together, and there were many fragments of kingdom that later on became many independent kingdoms. Okay, so we will study about this in the later part. In the second video of this lesson, I will be back again with the cultural contributions of the Bahmani kingdom, and we'll also study about the different rulers. As we studied, we know that Bahmani kingdom will not remain as one, they will split. So we will see what are those independent kingdoms and who are some of the important rulers in those kingdoms. I hope you enjoyed our video. I hope you understood everything that was explained. So again, one small reminder, thanks to all of you for making our channel very popular. I'm glad to announce that we are also starting online classes, because many of you have requested us. So if you want to join our live coaching or the live classes, please contact us immediately. You can call us on 99723-99337. You can also email to us on skillzenith@gmail.com or hello@skillzenith.com. You can also visit our website www.skillzenith.com and register right now. Remember, it is limited seats, so you will have to enroll right now. So thanks a lot for watching our videos. I will be back with the next part very soon.